finding the optima of a multivariable function is usually very difficult, if not impossible. And even more so if you have a constraint on your input variable. If you have a quadratic form though, this turns out to be a lot easier, as you will learn in this video. So, what's the situation? We are looking for maxima and minima of quadratic forms. So, we have our f of x is a quadratic form, so it can be written as x transpose times a times x, where a is a symmetric matrix and x is a vector. Now, a is a symmetric matrix, say n by n matrix, so we know that all eigenvalues are real. So we have lambda 1 up to lambda n real eigenvalues, and let's put them with the biggest first, so lambda 1 biggest eigenvalue until lambda n the smallest eigenvalue. Now we're going to find an optimum of this function with the constraint. The input variable in norm has to be 1. So what does that mean? If your x is in R2, for example, norm is 1, means that we are looking for a point lying on the circle, x1 squared plus x2 squared equals 1, and we are trying to find the optimum of our f under the constraint that our input variable lies on the circle. Or if x is in R3, then this constraint means that our input variable lies on the sphere. So with that constraint, we're trying to optimize our function f. Now, usually if you have some general function f, you can do this, then you need Lagrange multipliers and you get a lot of computations. However, in this case, it's a lot easier because we have a theorem that says that our f lies in between the biggest and the smallest eigenvalue. So f is always smaller than the biggest eigenvalue, and f is everywhere bigger than the smallest one. And also tells you where you can find this optimum. So the maximum is lambda n and the minimum is lambda 1. And the theorem also tells you where you can find it. And the maximum occurs at the biggest eigenvalue, so at u1. And the minimum occurs at the smallest eigenvalue at un. So we already know straight away where our maximum and where our minimum is. What the maximum is and what the minimum is. Well, why is that? Well, we have a symmetric matrix A, so let's prove this. A is an P transpose, where P is an orthogonal matrix, and we constructed such that we put our lambda 1 over here and our lambda n over there. So we start with the biggest eigenvalue and with the smallest eigenvalue, and then we define a new variable y. Y equals P transpose times x, because in this new variable y, our function, our quadratic form, becomes a lot easier. Why is that? Well, multiply by P, then you see P times y equals P transpose x, but P times P transpose is identity matrix, because P is orthogonal, so we get x. So we have both y equals P transpose times x, and P times y equals x. Now, our x is normalized, we will show first that our y is normalized as well. So we compute the inner product of y with itself, and this is the same as computing y transpose times y, so that's what we do over here. We know that y equals p transpose times x, so we have here the y transpose times y. Now if you take the transpose of a product, you take the product of the transposes in opposite order, so that's what we do over here. So we get an x transpose times p transpose transpose, which is p, times p transpose times x. However, this term in the middle is again identity, so we get x transpose times x, but x transpose times x is the same as x inner product with x, but x was normalized, so this is 1, so that means that y is also normalized. Okay, so a lot of work has been done, but now we can show what we want to show as follows. So we know that our f of x equals x transpose times a times x. Now we replace the x by p times y. So here we have x transpose, and we replace a by p dp transpose, and we replace the x again by p times y. And then we get, if you work out the product, we you get the y transpose times p transpose times p, cancels out, times d times p transpose times p again, identity times y. So we are just left with y transpose times d times y. So if you express our f in terms of our new variable y, we just get f of x equals lambda 1 y1 squared plus lambda 2 y2 squared and so on, plus lambda n times yn squared, because we just have a diagonal matrix in between. And that's nice, because now we can do the use the following trick. Now the lambda 1 is the biggest eigenvalue. So if you replace all lambdas over here by a lambda 1, we make this expression on the right-hand side bigger, because all the y1 squareds are positive. So if we're going to replace all lambdas, we may turn them all in lambda 1, then we make all terms bigger. So that means that the f is in fact smaller than this expression over here, where all lambdas have been replaced by lambda 1. That's what we do over there. Now, and then we're basically done. We take the lambda 1 out, and we get lambda 1 times y1 squared plus y2 squared plus y3 squared, and so on. So that's lambda 1 times the norm of y squared. That's what we have over here. But the norm of y squared equals 1, so we end up with lambda 1. So there we have that f is smaller or equal than lambda n. Now we can do a similar trick with the lambda n's. So the lambda n is the smallest eigenvalue. So if we replace all eigenvalues in this right-hand side by a lambda n, we make the whole expression smaller, which means that the function f is bigger than this expression if we put lambda n's everywhere. And then we have the same argument. You can take the lambda n out. You get lambda n times the norm of y squared, which is just lambda n. So f is bigger or equal than lambda n everywhere. And then we have proven the first part. So f is smaller than lambda 1 and f is bigger than lambda n. So the maximum, if it occurs is at the function at most lambda 1, and a minimal value, you cannot go below lambda n. So do we actually attain these points? Well, yes, we do. That is the second part. We take a normalized eigenvector u1 belonging to lambda 1. So we have a times u1 equals lambda 1 times u1. Plug it into your f of u1. So what do you get? u1 transpose a u1. But a times u1 equals lambda 1 times u1. Take the lambda 1 out, you get u1 transpose times u1. But we took a normalized eigenvector, so that's 1. So we get lambda 1. So the f at u1 equals lambda 1. So that's the maximal value at you can be at most lambda 1. You reach that value at u1. So that's your maximum. And similarly for the minimum, then you take u n, the eigenvector, normalized eigenvector belonging to lambda n. You know a times u n equals lambda n times u n. Plug it in. The f at u n is then u n transpose a u n. A times u n equals lambda n times u n. Take the lambda n in front, you get u n transpose u n. That's the norm of u n, but the eigenvector was normalized, so you get lambda n. So we also attain the minimum at u n, and its value is lambda n. So there we are. If you have a quadratic form, you know what the maximum is, the biggest eigenvalue. You know what the minimum is, smallest eigenvalue. And you know that you will attain them and where you will attain them.